everybody. Here we go. It is Friday. New Agent Class 23-10. Fingers are crossed. How are we doing this morning?
Awesome. Great.
Wonderful.
All right. I love it. It's getting better and better, better and better every single day. Hey, I put the graphic up there because it is Friday and it is a grind, right? Friday has a grind. We continue to work through every single day that you're with me. And George, what a song switch. Yeah, I felt that the previous song, which I really like, was kind of, sad. So I just wanted to go some Kings and Queens out there and let's get pumped up to get through the next 4 hours with me, because I know if I look at Riley, she is completely and utterly bored and like, oh my God, do we really have to do this on Friday? Riley, what state are you in?
I'm in Indiana.
You're in Indiana? What?
So it's like noon.
You're in Indiana?
Yeah.
So you should be wide awake, Riley. Those of us here on the West Coast, we're just trying to wipe the sleep from our eyes. All you
when I get off here, it's like 8:30, and then I have to like put my kids to bed and go to sleep. And I wake up and I have to take care of them.
So when you say, you're talking about after the fact, you're with the field trainers and you got to do some work there. And then, okay, so you know what you do today's Friday? You say, hey, you know what? I'm stopping at 6. You know why?
Why? You know why?
Because the whole reason we enticed you to come into this business, we said you would have the ability to control your own hours, right?
Yeah.
So give yourself a break. You spend some time with the family. I mean, this is important
stuff. I'll probably stay for class.
Hey, if you don't want to spend time with the family, totally fine. I understand. That's fine. I will still be here. Hey, let's get those camera on. Wade, Brent, Ava, Adrian, Marinette, Kelly, Kaylee, all these folks. Excuse me. I can't hear for some reason. Going to log in again. All right, Camille. Wayne Drawl, good morning. What can I do for you?
Good morning. Good morning, sir. How you doing?
I am well. Thank you.
I really like the statement that you just made about that is the reason that you start this business, because you can make your own hours.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good statement. So you know what? I'm stopping at 12:10.
No, Wayne, you don't get to do that.
I'm sorry, is he saying that he's going to sign off the training class at 12:10?
I think he's joking.
Oh, that's but you can if you want. No one is going to begrudge you if that's what you want to do. All right. So let's see how many people have already submitted their DRB report. What do you think the odds are that a lot of you have submitted? Do you think it's over 10? Do we think it's over 20? Let's take a look at the videotape. And the videotape tells us, excuse me, tells us that I still have a cough. I don't know what is going on. Now I'm waiting and I'm waiting and it's taking forever. Okay, here it comes up. I have on the 19th, we have 21 people already submitted. Look at that. I love it. We're heading in the right direction. Sherry, you're my timekeeper. 10 minutes from now, let's see if everyone can get it done. And Sherry, your hand is up. What can I do for you?
Oh, it was up from before. I just removed it.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Jack Glidden, is your hand up?
No, we're good.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to share a graphic with you while we're trying to actually fill out the DRB report. So now I got to move things around, but I want to take a look at this together and I want to see how we do as a class. So I have to share my screen and here we go. Have I shown this graphic to this class before?
No.
Okay. So on this graphic, it's called the emotional granularity wheel, circle, however you want to look at it. I typically view it as a wheel. Excuse me. And what it's doing is it's giving us an idea of what emotions we have at what time and what we will see as an impact of said emotions. So let's see if I can do that. Okay, so right here, the core emotions are surprised, bad, fearful, angry, disgusted, sad, or happy. And then it moves out from that. So if someone, as an example, is hostile, we can perceive that as aggressive and that they're angry at their core emotion. Okay? So what I try to make people understand is when we are talking to our clients, we want to be in control. We don't want to be feeling bad, fearful, angry, disgusted, or sad. We want to be somewhere around here. So we're going to analyze me in the 5 days that we've been together. And we're going to see what you all think so far of how I've interacted with this class. It is instructive because we will circle around and we'll come back to the whole reason that we're doing this. So let's start with somebody that I know has been in class the entire time, Erica Daniel. Good morning. How are you?
Good morning. I'm good.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. Erica, for the entire part of this class, which one of the core emotions have I consistently demonstrated?
Happy.
Okay, happy. Sarah Desimone. I just love that last name, Desimone. It's rolls. Sarah, which one would you say I have consistently demonstrated?
I would say happy as well.
You would say happy as well. Let's go to Riley. Well, no, I already talked to you about Kyle. There we go. Get a gentleman's perspective. Kyle, what? Kyle's like, I'm angry all the time. Kyle, what emotion have I typically demonstrated?
I was thinking more disgusted. No, happy.
Is that what you want to go with? Disgusted?
Yeah. We'll go with happy.
Okay, so happy. Sophia Jackman. Are you there?
Yes, I am, Sam. Sad. I'm kidding. Happy.
Well, okay, thank you very much. But my question is, have I ever exemplified surprise, bad, fearful, angry, disgusted, or sad?
Yes.
Which one?
Only when you're joking, but for the most part, on a serious note, happy. But like when you're giving jokes to get us in a different mood or to smile, you put a little surprise, like when you said that we were to pay you $5,000 each. Our emotions were very.
Oh my gosh. Is that how you remembered it? And I said, yeah, I don't think it was $5,000. I think it was $1,000, but that's okay. If you want to pay me $5,000 at the end, I'm totally down with that. No issues. Yes. Sherry Spirek, going to this section here. So we're going out from happy. Well, first of all, do you agree that I typically display happy?
Yes.
Okay, so going out from there, which one of these do you think I display most often?
Optimistic.
Optimistic. Okay, there it is. Optimistic. Okay. Jason. Are you there, Jason?
Yeah, I'm here.
Which one of these, well, one, do you agree with happy is typically my emotion that I show?
Most definitely. I would say maybe anywhere in the yellow.
Well, if you feel that I typically show yellow, I'm just looking for this one right here. This
okay,
one.
I was going to say confident, but okay. Proud.
Proud. Okay, that's fair. Priyanka, how about you?
Yeah, I would also say powerful.
Powerful?
Yeah, because you're like you have the hold of the class, so I would say powerful.
Okay, powerful. Michael Witherby, although I know I'm going to regret this. Which one? Hey, Michael's not in the shadows today. What's going on? Is it just me?
You're lucky you recognize that. I went out and bought a ring light just for you last night at 8:30 at night. I had a horrible day, but I still did that for you.
Is everything okay?
Yeah, you don't want to hear the whole story, but
I don't, but I just want to make sure you're okay.
Yeah, everything's good. It's just a nightmare of an evening for me.
Okay, fair enough. And now you have a ring light and we can all see you. So that's great.
Great.
Would you say that I'm typically happy?
Typically? Yeah, typically you're happy.
And so which one of these would you say describes me?
Let's see. Well, see, I would have went interested and then confident, but those don't line up. So I guess I'll just go proud.
Okay, so proud. That's fine. Olga, Olga's like, don't call on me. Olga, are you prepared with your A1 opening?
You are trusting. I trust that you would not ask.
Wait, is trusting? You know what, Olga? That was awesome. That was excellent. Very proud of you right there. That was awesome. Wayne Draw.
I'm proud too. That was
Wayne. Excuse me, Wayne Draw. For you, my friend, outside of this, we're looking at this one here. At the larger picture of happy. Which one of these during our time together that we've been in class would you say describes me?
You are courageous.
Courageous. Right here. Okay.
Yes. Courageous and you're also powerful. You're also confident of the knowledge that you have.
Okay.
And then you are also sensitive on how you come across due to the fact that you know you are dealing with different personalities. So that is good.
Okay. So you all have now, to some extent, analyzed me. And the extent that you've analyzed isn't that you sat down and you had a pen and paper and you had this wheel and you're like, okay, well, what is Sam doing today or whatever? No, it's more intrinsic than that. This is what you feel that I've been portraying to you for 4 days straight. One second. Maxie, I don't recognize you, Maxie. Who are you?
I'm new. I came over from Eric Statler's class. He had a family emergency, so I was switched over to this class.
Okay,
so
no worries. Yeah. All right, so we'll chat later, okay?
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, no worries whatsoever. Okay, so Adrian Hall, that's who's... Okay, so go ahead and mute yourself, Maxie.
Okay, I did.
All right, perfect. All right, so we've had this idea now of I'm asking you, what do you think about me? In terms of how I portray how you think I might be feeling. So now here's the question. Chris Cole, now you're in the shadows. I love it. All right, Chris. So we have surprised, feeling bad, feeling fearful, angry, disgusted, sad, and happy. The class in general says I come across as happy. But do you think at any point in time during class or maybe before class or after that any of those other emotions have played a factor in my life?
Sure.
Yeah. So, Rebecca, if that's true, why in the world does the class only get the sense that I feel happy?
Because you're very good at your job.
I don't know about that. So let's try one more time, though. But why do you think that is? Even if you think I'm good or not good or whatever, why do you think I'm projecting happy as opposed to maybe I'm feeling a different way?
Because we will feed off of you.
Ah, so I'm trying to find or I'm trying to elicit a response from every one of you in the class, aren't I? Correct. Okay, Sherry, your hand's up. What can I do for you?
Hands up.
Time's up. Oh, okay, so let me get off my little soapbox and then I'll check. So the whole point of this discussion is to say, okay, we're not always going to feel one particular way on the emotional granularity wheel, right? We may feel fearful. As a matter of fact, I talk about fear spikes a lot. Right. The first fear spike is when someone answers the phone. Next one is when they actually say they want an appointment. And then the next one is when you actually have to present to a client or you're presenting as part of a test in order to get released. So you're going to be fearful over here. In some circumstances, you're going to be angry. You're going to be angry because your client is not going to buy. Your client's not interested. They're not listening to you. Or you're going to be disgusted with a client. For no other reason than, let's just say the husband and wife are married, the wife doesn't have any money, the husband's the only one working, and he just says to you, well, I don't really care what happens because once I'm dead, I'm dead. and you're looking at him, and he's sitting right next to the woman he professes love to, and the woman's look on her face is just utter disbelief. Yeah, that's happened to me, I think, 4 times in my career, where I couldn't sell anything. And twice, the husband's died. So there's a certain level of disgust I may have, right? You may feel sad. Something's going on in your day. You're frustrated. Let's see what we got. Depressed. You feel guilty about something that happened. You have despair. Maybe you didn't have enough money to pay the bills. Or in my case, my daughter is moving to San Francisco. I feel despair that she won't be, you know, as close to me as she is. Or maybe you feel isolated because the job that you now have, you don't actually interact with people as much as you did with the jobs that you had before. Or you just may feel bad in general because you're overwhelmed right here, right? You're overwhelmed. There's so much information coming at you. You have the script. You have the phone script. You have the presentation script. You've got HP Pro. You've got EAP. You've got me. You've got your upline. You have your family putting pressure on you. And oh, by the way, you got to pay the bills. So maybe you feel overwhelmed. Or maybe you feel sleepy. And that's why I try to help you every morning get up, or every afternoon for some of you, to get up and really get going. Or you might be surprised for whatever reason. I will tell you that I bounce around between happy and surprised. You've heard me do that sometimes. And it's not that I am surprised in the sense of, oh, I'm shocked, I can't believe it's happening. I usually use confused or perplexed. Yeah, because I'll ask you a question, and based on your response, what do I do, Michael Witherby, when I am confused? What do I do? You know? You remember?
Yeah, you turn your head to the side and laugh.
Really?
They're doing it right now. You just did it.
Or I'll ask for you to say it again.
Yeah.
Or I won't say anything, right? I'll just look at you.
Well, I mean, usually you ask for clarification if you don't understand something, which is what the right thing to do would be.
Do you think I truly don't understand something?
I mean, I assume there's times when questions are asked in an awkward way where you need clarification for what the person is asking.
Or maybe I'm just confused that you didn't understand what I just said. And then, you know what I mean? So I have to say it again. My point there is I use it for a reason. I'm typically not confused or perplexed. I'm just playing that role, just like I play the happy role. And I want us to think about it. I'm doing it every day for 4 hours, or in some cases longer. But I do it because it has no value for me to be fearful or to be angry or be disgusted or sad or feeling bad with 37 people. Just like it makes no difference to your client if you feel any of those things. What makes a difference is if you project those things. How many of us, if I was sad, how many of us would tune out? Show of hands. How many people would be like, oh my God, there he goes again? Yeah, well, maybe 3 of you. Okay, so a few of you. And Chanel Bartlett's like, yeah, definitely. I'm already tuned out. That's just going to make it worse. So when you're sitting with your client or you're making a phone call, we talked a little bit yesterday about the presentation script for the phone calls, and we're saying some will, some won't, so what? But we're also saying they have no idea what perspective you're coming from. The flip or the other side of the coin to that is that you have no idea where they're coming from. That's why rapport is so crucial. If you don't build rapport, you have no idea where they're coming from, and you don't know if they're surprised, feeling bad, fearful, angry, sad, disgusted. You don't know any of those things until something happens. And now you're going to be surprised, right? So if we're building rapport a little bit, we're going to have an idea of their human behavior. Literally within that hour, we'll know. How many of you think I have a fairly good insight onto how you all feel at any given time? Let's ask Priya. Priya, do you think I have an idea of how you feel? And when I say you, I'm talking about the class as a whole, not you specifically, but the class as a whole.
Probably.
Yeah. You think when I notice that Ogle never looks into the camera the entire time that she may be not wanting to be called on? Could I get that sense?
Yeah, 100%.
Could I get the sense from Morgan Kelly? kind of the same thing. Don't call me. Or Kendall English, that looks in the camera almost 90% of the time, just waiting to be called on because she's prepared and ready to go.
Wow. I'm really not, guys.
But you're projecting that. Yeah. So I'm interpreting that just like I want you all to interpret that with me. When you come into class next week, every single day, I want you to think about this Will and say, okay, how is he projecting today? Is it any different than any other day? Yes, Morgan, what can I do for you?
I was going to say most of my looking down is because I'm taking notes.
Well, I wasn't judging. Excuse me.
It felt like you were judging.
No, see, you're interpreting that. I am not judging the fact that any of you look down. I would probably look down quite a bit. As a matter of fact, I look at my screens and I'm not looking up at the camera that's a little bit above my eye level. By the way, at some point I'm buying a teleprompter, a studio quality teleprompter. So the reflection of my screen will show up right in front of me. So even though I'm looking at my screen, the camera thinks I'm looking at you. Why am I spending the money to do that? Because I want you to think I'm connecting with you more and more. Unfortunately, I can't do it this class. I'm going to do it later. So the whole, not the whole, but the intent of this, excuse me, this part of this discussion to say, okay, how are we coming across? What are we doing? If you have frustration with your upline, okay, let's just, as and I don't know if anybody does, but I'm just going to give you an example. Let's say I can't get a hold of my upline. Every single time I try to call them, they're busy. They're in a sit. They're coaching others, whatever it is that they're doing. And I'm trying to get leads or I'm trying to get information about how to do X, Y, and Z. Okay. Let's say Janelle is my upline. And every single time Janelle's not available, I text her, there's no response. So finally, Janelle calls me back. And I go, oh my God, Janelle, I've been trying to get a hold of you forever. What's going on? What will Janelle think immediately? Janelle, what would you think immediately? See, I'm learning. This class is teaching me every day. Janelle, what would you think if I said, oh my God, Janelle, thank God I finally got a hold of you. I've been trying to get a hold of you for a week. You're non-responsive. You're my upline. What would you think about me immediately?
I would kind of, my back would kind of raise immediately. I'd be like, you're coming at me with attitude. Like, you're not even giving me a chance to explain to you why. It would come across as confrontational for sure.
Confrontational. So she's going to interpret that particularly because I'm a man and I'm probably, you know, 6'3", 220. So physically, I'm probably intimidated, but now she's feeling it if I'm coming across like that in a Zoom meeting. So if I said, hey, Janelle, awesome, I got a hold of you. Here's my issue. Can you help me? Just that little twist makes me come across as what? Playful, trusting, optimistic, all the things under happy. Now, if I were to do that, Janelle, how do you think I'm coming across?
Much more like personably. The change in tone immediately changes it from like accusation to it makes it seem like you're happy to actually get a hold of me.
There you go. And the statistics tell us that more people feel happy, the more they project that, the more likely people will speak with them, whether it's your significant other, whether it's your kids, whether it's your clients, whether it's your leadership, doesn't matter. So the whole point here is don't, you can feel the way that you feel, but don't project it. The more you project it, the more people are going to interpret it. And invariably, we interpret it incorrectly, right? Because the way I said that to Janelle is not I'm being accusatory or anything like that. I'm just frustrated. But she's going to take it through her prism and she's going to think something different than what I'm intending. So if I'm talking to a client, I want to make sure every time I get on that phone call or every time I get into the Zoom, I'm putting on the show. And we're going to see a video here in a few minutes. We're putting on a show. Again, I don't want you to be fake. I just want you to think about if you were on the other side of that screen, just like all of you are now in this class, how would you want me to be? If I'm in the happy zone more often than not, and not the ridiculous happy zone, right? But in the genuinely interested to see you, and I don't have any negative thing to say, I'm here to help, et cetera, et cetera. Are you more inclined to chat with me? So it's a rhetorical question. The next part is, are you more than likely going to like me? if I raise the bar a little bit in terms of you liking me, guess what? You're going to buy from me. Just like in this class, if I was any other way and I'm giving you information, the likelihood you're going to buy into it is actually lower if I'm emotionally all over the map. Just like in a sit with a client, if you come across as optimistic, non-threatening, interested in what they're doing, then they're going to like you more. And that little bit of more could be the difference of getting a sale and not getting a sale. I'm so sorry, Morgan, your hand is up and then went down. How can I help you?
I was just going to say, as long as you're not like overtly like crazy happy, it just reminds me of this one time I was calling T-Mobile and the chick's name was Happy and she made that her whole spiel. So like at like maybe 2 minutes into the call, I couldn't wait to get off the phone with her because she was just so over the top.
It's too sugary, right? Too sweet. However, what I'm telling you is be who you are. Just don't allow the other emotions you may be feeling or may have just experienced prior to the engagement with the client to seep through. So let's find out from this class, let's ask the men because they're the ones who usually tell the truth when it comes to a question about my personality. Jack Glidden, am I too sweet? Do I come across as syrupy or fake or too happy?
The least bit sweet.
Did you say
no?
Okay, no. God, thank you.
You come off happy.
I told you the men just lay it right out there.
I was ready James. To lay it out there.
James, how about you? Do I come across as too sweet? James and the hold button are.
No, you don't.
Okay, gotcha. So I just want us all to think about that. And to think about it in the context, you have to practice what you preach. So Kyle, am I giving any type of guidance in this particular block of instruction that is at odds with what you know and what you've experienced in your career?
No, absolutely not. You're spot on. It doesn't matter how you feel. It doesn't matter how you think. What matters is what we do, what you do.
Okay, there you go. It doesn't matter. It matters what we do. I love it. Okay, so let me look at the number of people who have actually submitted the DRB. There are 36 of you in this room, and I have 30. I have 30. So hold on. Is George here? George is probably here. George, you have your second computer up. Do you? Nope, you do not. Wait,
what? Yeah, this is me. I got my my cam now.
So, all right, so you only have one login into the Zoom, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Maxi, you probably have not submitted a DRB, correct? Maxi?
I have not heard of one, so because we didn't do any in the other class.
Okay, no worries. So there's a link right there. What I want you to do, it's in the chat. I want you to click on that and fill out all of your information, okay?
I was trying to do that, but I don't have, I just learned your name. And who is the RGA?
Well, in your case, well, first of all, I'm not the trainer. The trainer is going to be the person that you talk to after the class. Who have you been meeting with after class?
James Hodges.
Yeah, so you're going to put James Hodges. He's your trainer. Your RGA is Mark Dushai.
Can you spell the last name for me?
Dushaj.
Okay, no problem. Okay. I'll do that. I'll do that now.
You're awesome. I appreciate it. Thank you. Has anybody else not submitted their DRB report? All right. I'm assuming that you have because I'm going to turn in the attendance. Marionette, are you there? Adrian, Brent, Crystal.
Yeah.
Have you all turned in your DRB report?
I did.
Thank you.
No, sorry. This is Adrian Hall. I'm traveling. I had death in the family. No, I have not submitted anything.
Okay. Oh, I'm so sorry about your loss, Adrian.
Thank you.
All right. I'm going to play a video now for everybody. I'm going to try to play a video. It's called Performing the Presentation, and then we'll talk about it on the other side, okay? So let me try to play it. Let's see if it will actually work. It looks like it will. It's only 6 minutes, so it's not a very long, drawn-out one. So let's go to the video.
Performing the presentation is the most important stepping stone to success in our business. In order to teach you how to perform, you have to know what to say. So here's what you need to take away from this module. Number one, the presentation is a performance. That's it. Having a great presentation is the common denominator between everyone that is successful with AO. When we explain the benefits to the client in a clear, simple presentation, that they understand what their needs are and they look to our benefits to be their solution. Over the last 40 years, we've learned that anyone can be successful at AO regardless of their past experience or their personality type. AO sales presentation has been developed by the best salespeople in the company. It's a living, breathing document that continues to be fine-tuned to help you become successful. Performing the presentation word for word, it's not a suggestion. It is an expectation. The presentation script has been written to help you enroll more of your presentations while also ensuring that the client, the company, and you are compliant with your explanation of our products. So, how do you master the presentation? Well, it's practice, practice, practice. Have you ever read a story so many times that you know every part of it before you even turn the page? Well, of course, we all have. And reading the script out loud is a key to having a great presentation. When you read the script out loud, you'll learn the script in two different ways. Not only do you learn the words by reading, but you also learn the words by hearing yourself say them. On top of all of that, you will learn your presentation even faster, because in your training, you will get to hear and see your trainer present the same presentation over and over and over again until you are ready to present to our clients. So let's get started with an example that will make sense to you. Your presentation needs to be a performance. Remember, it's called a presentation, not a lecture. That's because the client needs to have ups and downs to stay engaged. Your focus as the presenter is to perform the words that were written. We're not saying that you have to be a robot. We want you to be you. We have found that knowing what you will say versus having to think about what to say is what allows you to perform. So when you are presenting, you need to make it your own without changing any of the words. Let me give you an example. At school, sporting events, and concerts in the US and Canada, it's a tradition to start with, you guessed it, the national anthem. All of us know our national anthem because we have heard it so many times. So what separates a great version of the national anthem from one that's an absolute disaster? Well, it's the artist's performance. The artist doesn't have to change the words to make it great. They just perform. Each one of the artists performs the words of the anthem in their own style to make it their own. The words are all the same, in the same order, and what sets them apart is how they sing it. The same goes for your presentation. Let's take a look at this in action.
Can you see by the dawn's
early? Now that you know that your success is going to come down to how you perform the words of the presentation, let me teach you how to have a great performance. First, you need to set your computer up in a place where the internet's the fastest, where there's a good lighting source and is away from as many distractions as possible. Next, sit in a chair that helps you to have good posture. This will allow you to project your voice during your presentation. Be loud. As you're learning how to best communicate virtually, being loud will project confidence to the client. Talk slowly and clearly. Remember, this is the first time that they've heard the presentation. You want to use voice inflection. Changing your tone of voice and the speed you're reading will emphasize the important points of the presentation, and this will keep the client engaged. Be emotionally appropriate. That means when you are talking about them or their loved one passing away, talk more quietly and compassionately. An easy way to think of this is to use the same voice that you would use if you were talking to someone who's sitting on the first row of a funeral. Use planned pauses. This will ensure your words have the intended impact by letting them set in before moving to the next sentence. And lastly, when you ask a question, make sure to get a verbal answer. Head nods, they're not enough. You're asking questions to ensure they understand what you just talked about and that they are with you. So, you're probably thinking the same question that I had when I first started. When will I be ready to present to clients? That's simple. You'll get the chance to be on presentations with your trainer until you are ready to present on your own. When you're not watching your trainer present, you need to be practicing and saying your presentation out loud until you can say the presentation word for word using everything you've learned in this training. And so don't worry, as long as you are saying the words in the presentation the best that you can, your presentation will get better and better and better. The more repetitions that you get, the better you will get and the sooner you will master the presentation. Now be sure to watch this video as many times as you need to solidify what you've learned and get the most out of your training.
All right, so there we go. The presentation is a performance, right? So what that means to me is each one of you are going to be a little bit different. Some of you are going to be nervous. Some of you are going to be perfectly fine. Some of you are going to be flawless. Some of you are going to make mistakes on HP Pro, but it's a performance. Any of us play sports when we were younger, right? You played sports when you were younger. Were all of us really good at the sport when we were younger? I was. No, I'm just kidding. So we get better as we play. How many of us play a musical instrument? Anybody? I used to play guitar when I was a little kid. Okay, some of you play musical instruments. I can almost guarantee when you picked it up, you weren't very good until you learned how things work, and then you got better and better as you played it. Piano is a perfect scenario. You can have really good, a good ear, but until you learn how the keys work in conjunction with each other, you can't get to the notes that you want. Some of us are gifted and we can hear it and we can start to play it, but even those people, it takes a while before they get really good. And then those of us who are tone deaf, it'll take us forever, but we will get better if we practice it. Yeah. So your presentation is the same concept. You have to practice it. And that's why we talk about the race to 100. Because we're assuming before the race to 100 even begins, you've practiced it in this class, you've practiced it on your own, you've practiced it with family, friends, or whatever, and now you're in front of a client, you have the fear spike, you get through that. By the time you get to 100 presentations, you're going to feel much better about utilizing the tools, HP Pro, eApp, anything else that you touch, as well as the script in and of itself. Is that a fair statement, Marionette?
It definitely is a fair presentation, a fair word, yes.
Mm-hmm. I think you're echoing Marionette, no problem. Erica Daniel, would you agree with Marionette that that's a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay, so that being the case, Erica is going to have us take a little test. Thank you, Erica, for segueing into the test. What I would like you all of you to do is raise your hand electronically if you have practiced this script, your presentation script, more than 20 times since class started on Monday. Jason has his hand up. And then it went quickly down. So all of you have been in class now for 4 days. That means you would have only had to practice five times every day to get to 20, right? And we're saying none of us have practiced. So Sarah, is that because we're completely confident and we got this and it's no big deal?
No, not at all. I have not gone through the entire thing with somebody. I'm a auditory learner, so I've really been listening to a couple presentations and I'm super excited to practice today. And also I have a practice day scheduled with my girls on Sunday. But I heard a lot of presentations now, so I'm excited to see where I'm at.
So that's for you personally. Why do you think no one else has done 20 repetitions of the script? I'm just curious. What do you think the reason is?
There's a lot of different things to start learning. So maybe they didn't know that that was the main focus that they should be doing. I'm not sure.
Okay, so you're interpreting me. I am not saying it is the main focus. In my mind, the main focus was HB Pro and understanding that how you speak to people makes a difference, right? That's the two things I wanted you to get out of this entire week. Now we're shifting into the actual presentation itself. So for all of you will have homework, and I'm going to tell you what it is right now. So please write it down. By midnight Pacific time tomorrow, which is Saturday, you need to send me a video of a Zoom recording with you and your role play partner. I don't care who it is. They're acting as the client, you're acting as the agent, and you're going to role play part A of whatever presentation you're going to do. For the US, it's mostly going to be the veteran market. For the rest of you in Canada, it will be either the McGruff or the No Cost Kit. You're going to do part A. And in the title of the email that you send me, it's going to say class 23-010 video. That email has to include a copy of the video, as well as any items you had to download that you're going to give the client. So remember, you in the upper right-hand corner of the family information guide, as an example, you click on that, you get the three little spinning circles, and then it downloads a PDF file, and that's what you're going to send the client at the end. I need you to send that to me. Now, some of these videos are going to be too large. Fully understand. What you have to give me is the location where the file is, and if there's a password. So if you're recording it on Zoom or saved it to the cloud on Dropbox or Google Drive or whatever, you just need to tell me where it is so I can go and grab it, pull it down, and I can view it. Because what happens on Sunday, I'm sure somebody heard me say this, right? Somebody asked me, what am I going to do this weekend? Guess what? Sunday morning at 10 a.m. my time, I start watching all your videos. Olga, what do you think I'm looking for when I'm watching those videos?
That you know how to do it by now.
Olga, it's very literal. You really don't want me calling on you anymore, huh?
Okay.
So what I'm looking for is a number of different things, which I will put in an email by Sunday night when I give the feedback on the videos to all of you. I'm looking for themes. I'm looking for patterns. What I am not looking for is, I don't know, a hockey game that somebody recorded and sent it to me by accident instead of the video. I'm also, just so we're perfectly clear, I am not looking for body parts. I'm not looking for accidentally things happening in the background that I don't need to see. So to that point, please watch your video before you send it to me, please, to make sure that you feel comfortable with what you're sending me is professional and I should be seeing, and secondarily, that you did the best that you could. I've had students do it up to 20 times. Doesn't matter to me. I don't need to see 20. I just need to see the one you're going to submit. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. You have to have that done by midnight tomorrow, but you're going to get let go out of class. You can do it right after class. You could work with each other and say, hey, Ava, this is Amber, and I need help, or I need to work with you. Are you down to work with me? And Ava's like, yeah, absolutely, I'll work with you. So you guys work it out together. It doesn't matter to me who you use as your role play partner. However, what matters is the moment you start, there's no one helping you. So if you're going to use Ava, Erica, you can't stop in the middle and go, hey, Ava, I don't know how to do this. Can you tell me? No, I don't want you to submit that video. If she helps you, that's great. Stop the video, start it over. Does that make sense? I want to see that you can get all the way through part A. Whatever part A is for you, I want to see that done. So that way I can get a sense of, okay, let me look at the lighting. Let me look how you speak into the camera. Did you turn your camera off? Do you have control? Do you have confidence? Are you navigating according to the script? All those things. This is not me evaluating how good you're doing. It is just me determining where you're at after 1 week. Because guess what? Next Thursday, all of you have to pass a presentation rubric. Does anybody know what the presentation rubric is? And for those of you who had questions, I'll be right with you. Does anybody know what the presentation rubric is? I'm assuming no one does because no one's saying anything. Is that a fair statement?
Mm-hmm. It's okay. Like where you're graded on your performance to see if you can do each thing. I was looking through the new agent packet and saw that.
Who said that? That was awesome. Who was
that? That's Helene Garcia.
Helene, yes. In the new agent packet. I'm sorry, it's not the new agent packet. It's an actual attachment.
Yeah.
And that attachment is number 20. So let me show you what that looks like so you can get a sense of what will happen to you on Thursday. You're going to sit down with your upline or a representative of your upline, maybe an SA, maybe a GA. I don't know, but they're going to have you sit down with somebody and they're going to have you go through this. And you're going to have to do the entire presentation from the opening all the way through to the closing question. And they will probably tell you they can't afford it, and you have to overcome that, or at least attempt to. Each section is broken down by parts, or each part rather is broken down for individual scores in certain areas all the way through. Now, some of you don't have the three important facts because you're not in the veteran market. I totally get it. But most of the stuff down here is definitely on par. All I want you to do is part A for the video so I can give you feedback on what I'm seeing. But when you do your presentation rubric, otherwise known as attempting to get released, because in order for you to be quote unquote released, you have to pass the rubric. Yeah. So somebody's going to be evaluating you and giving you a score. The total score max or the max total score is 200 points. And each part is worth 50. You need 150 points to pass the rubric. So right here in part A is the only thing that I am concerned about for right now. I just want to know, where are you relative to that? How comfortable you feel, how well you can navigate through the pieces, how well you can follow the script, all of those types of things. And in less than a week, you're going to have to get through all the rest. Now, if we think about it, this right here, the transition letter, we've already practiced that a few times. We've built plans. So the most difficult part of this rubric, you all have done already. You've already shown me you know how to do it. If I had taught this a different way, if I just started at the beginning and went through this and said, hey, you're going to be graded now on trying to do these plans, you'd freak out. Because I've seen it. People, when they have to start building a plan and they don't know what to say and it's taking too long, they start to get stressed. Now that you know how to build a plan and you know what all the policy means, you can actually get that done and not be concerned about that. And then getting through the rest of it is just showing us all the information, basically following the script. So going back to the homework, by midnight, tomorrow night, Pacific time, you need to send me an email that has all the downloads that you need to download. Some markets only have one PDF to download. The veteran market has four. I need to see all of those. You need to fill out all the sections. So what I mean by that is, if you have space for five family members, I need five family members. If it's four emergency contacts, I need four emergency contacts. So whatever is the default, you need to fill it out completely. Now, Sherry's looking at me like, well, why do I have to fill it out completely? Because we know what we're doing. Yes, Sherry, absolutely. You do know what you're doing, but I need you to feel what it takes in terms of time to get through a fully populated presentation through part A. Because remember, in our minds, by 30 minutes, we want to be where? At the needs analysis screen, right? So we're not there yet. I just want to see how long, and for you to gauge, how long it took you to get through part A. Again, I'm not looking for efficiency, I'm looking for effectiveness. Yeah. Then you need to either attach your recording to the email, or give me the information in the email where the link is so I can go get it. And if there's a passcode, give me the passcode so I can get in there. If I don't have it by midnight, then it's considered late and I will not look at it. Excuse me. You have 2 full days to get it done. Yes, Andrew, what can I do for you?
Now, is that midnight East Coast or West Coast speaking?
Pacific time. So if you're on the East Coast, then you have a little more time if you want it.
Okay.
But I give you the homework now because I think what most people will do is they'll try to finish it today so they don't have to worry about it on the weekend. But the reason I have to do it on the last day of the first week is because it's going to take me 6 hours probably. What, 34 of you will submit videos. It'll take me at least 6 hours to get through all those videos. And I don't want to do it, you know, like on Thursday night at 2 a.m. in the morning. I don't want to do that. Is that fair? Does anybody think they're not able to send me their homework by midnight on Saturday? Because I understand sometimes you might not be able to, but I don't see any hands raised. Am I correct?
I have a conflict, but I wanted to talk to you about it after class.
Okay. And there's Marinette. Marinette, what's up?
I don't have anyone to practice with. So
You have no one to practice with?
Yes.
Okay. So what I would then do is put a message out to all the people in this class and say, hey, who can I practice with? Set up a time to practice and then have them be your role play when you actually do the recording.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Absolutely. Because I know it's a tough life you got. You're in Paris. The rest of us are not. Janelle Bartlett, are you about to tell me that you can't get it done by midnight on Saturday?
I'm in the same position as Sarah, so I was just going to talk to you at the end of class today. I'm going to do absolutely everything that I can to get it done, but I just want to touch base with you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's fine. This Saturday, the homework due. Yes, Sophia, is due by midnight Saturday in 2 days. Okay. And Maxie says, I am lost. Maxie, have they gone over the script with you? I don't know what they're doing in that other class.
No, we haven't.
Phone calls, right?
Just phone calls. That's it.
All right, Maxie. So you're going to stick around with the other two at the end of class today, okay?
Okay.
I'll figure something out for you because I know you're a special case. Is there anybody else that was in your class that's with us now?
No.
Just you. Okay.
Yeah.
No worries. Okay. So we understand the homework, George. We know what we're going to deliver, correct?
I had a question.
George, would you be so kind? Well, I'll answer your question, and then I want you to reiterate what the homework is to make sure that I have communicated. What is your question?
So you say it's going to take you 6 hours to watch all our videos. So that you're saying it's going to take us about 10 minutes to make this video. Shouldn't we get this in about 20 minutes? Like, I know you're not saying to put a number to it, but like, what's your like rough estimate of how long our part A should be?
I've seen people take 40 minutes on this, and I'm okay with that. The purpose here is not to have you rush through it. I want you to do it right and see how long it takes you. As you do this more and more, your efficiency will reduce the how long it takes. So I don't care how long it takes, because quite frankly, I'll probably fast forward through stuff that is repetitive. What I'm looking for is for you to get a feeling of how long it took. I can't tell you the number of students who are very confident, they know everything that's going on. They do this exercise and it takes them an hour and a half. And then they have a wake-up call like, oh my gosh, yeah, I just took too long in these certain areas.
Okay.
So now, could you reiterate for us, George, what exactly is the homework?
So, let me pull up my notes. Midnight Pacific tomorrow, we got to submit a recording with our clients of part A of our specific market. It is going to be titled Class 23-010 Video. It's going to contain the copy of the video, any items needed to download that you would give to the client. And that's it.
In some cases, their videos will be too big, so you're going to have to save it up on a web somewhere. So just give me the link and, if necessary, the passcode to get to it. Sophia Jackman, what can I do for you?
Just a question. Can I submit mine on Sunday morning? Because I just have one day to prepare. Tomorrow is Saturday for me.
So tomorrow is Saturday, I think, for everybody, right?
We have 2 days.
So you want more time is what you're telling me.
Yes, because today's my son's birthday and we have a little function for him. So I'm going to be a little bit exhausted.
Well,
you can't, that's fine.
No, hold on. So I think that's a fairly legitimate reason. And I told you all that the way that we entice people to join us is because we talk about, hey, we're family oriented. You're going to have time to spend with your family. And then the very first homework I give you is going to interrupt your family time. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. So Sophia, yes, you can submit yours on Sunday. But how about you tell me by what time will you submit it by? You make the commitment based on what you know you have going on.
By 1 p.m. Pacific time?
That's completely fine. Okay.
Thank you very much. Yes,
absolutely. And so just pay it forward. When you become an RGA and you've got people going through class and all these stuff, just remember that old guy with glasses gave you extra time to complete something. Yes, James, what can I do for you?
I was thinking that it would be really rude to interrupt your weekend, so we should maybe submit after the weekend so we're not taking up, time of yours.
Yeah, I think that would be a great idea in an alternative universe, but in my universe, I already have my Sunday planned out and is watching these videos. That's how much I am an advocate for all of you, yeah? So I give it to you today so you can do it as part of your field training time. If your upline lets you, you can do it then. That way it doesn't take any of your time. But I need to make sure I give the feedback to you and that we talk about it on Monday so we can continue to progress in the class. So although I appreciate your sentiment and your efforts and your soliloquy, I still need you to have it done by midnight on Saturday. Ava Lichter, what can I do for you?
So just to clarify, would the preferred method, or probably the only method I'm guessing, would to be like record your Zoom? So that way you can see like the HP Pro when we pull up like our shared screen and everything.
Absolutely. It won't do me any good to watch you not seeing what you're doing on HP Pro. The whole point of going into Zoom is one, so I know you know how to use Zoom, that you can use HP Pro, that you can stop sharing your camera, you can share your screen and follow the script. If you don't record in Zoom, I don't see any of that in the entire exercise. Not necessarily fruitless, but certainly not giving us as much fruit as we need. Is that fair?
Yep, totally.
Okay. Do we need any more clarification? Michael Witherby, I'm going to use you as my touchstone. Do we need any further flair? Do we need any more flair? Do we need any more? Oh, I can't speak the word anymore. Clarification.
Well, the only thing I was thinking is you might want to show people how to actually record in Zoom in case they don't know. But other than that, it's pretty clear.
Yeah. So down at the bottom of all of your Zooms, you have something that says start recording. Now, Michael always poking the bear. I love it. So part of the reason that I have you do this exercise is because we're expecting you to use Zoom when you talk to your clients. I want to know if you know how to use Zoom. I want to know if you're using the free version or if you've upgraded to where you should be at the pro version. Why? Because the free version has a limitation on how much time you can record, 40 minutes. So immediately that will tell me, yeah, you need to upgrade to the pro version so you can record more time. Secondarily, if you're using the free version and you do attempt to record, I believe it only records to your local hard drive. It doesn't allow you to record to Zoom's cloud. So these are little tricks that I'll find out about as you try to do the homework. And Michael, being Michael, knows that my little tricks, and so he wants to get it out there in front of everybody else already. So down at the lower bottom, you'll see where it says start recording. Right now, if you click on it, I think it says recording disabled by the host, I think. But when you have your own Zoom open, boom, you're going to be able to record. If you have the free version, you haven't upgraded yet, you may want to reach out through the chat and ask somebody, hey, do you have the professional version of Zoom? And if you do, can I work with you as your role play partner? And can you record our session together? Just as a thought, right? Now that's efficacy. I'm getting it done. How effective I am is different, and efficiency I don't care about right now. Janelle Bartlett.
So I know personally with my upline, they have like their own offices. And as you get released into the field, you actually get your own virtual office.
Yeah.
Would you recommend we?
No. I'm going to give you, are you in Canada?
I am, yes.
Okay, so in Canada, as in some of the other uplines, they want you to come into their office and they'll give you a room you can go into. The problem with that, it's not bad, is that you don't control that whatsoever, right? You have no control over that. You're an independent agent. You're your own business owner. So I'm going to take that whole thing and move it aside for a second. I don't
believe. So you do still recommend getting it?
What's that?
You do still recommend getting the pro, even if your upline has that lined up.
Yeah, and I would recommend that every single sit that you do is on your own Zoom. I mean, think about it for a second. Let's say that it's everything is through your upline, and for whatever reason, your upline is in Cancun and they're not available and the Zoom doesn't work. What do you do? What do you do? You have no control, right? The worst thing for an independent business owner is to have zero control. The whole point, you're an independent business owner, is so you have all the control. Yeah. So if it's somebody else's Zoom, like Ashley Rust Zoom or Team Hyro Zoom, as an example, they have rooms open, but they don't make you join that one. They want you to have your own Zoom so you can talk to your clients. What they want you to do is join the Zoom room for education, for training, for camaraderie, all that type of stuff. Okay. But they don't give you the ability to record in there, just like I don't give you the ability to record here. I can record, but I don't give it to you. You need to record yourself. And in my mind, you want to have your own Zoom moving into the future. So that way you can control when you have Zoom, when you have appointments, and if you want to record those appointments or whatever. Again, I'm an advocate for you. Yes, I know what they do in Canada, and I'm happy that they do that and they make that available to you. Just think it through long term. One of the things you'll know, Bobby, has anybody looked at my LinkedIn profile? Any one of you looked at me? All right, Ava Lichter. George has, Ava has. On there, I talk about what? What do I do? It's all about risk mitigation. Almost my entire career has been wrapped around that, whether it's in sales or not. It's all about working with clients to minimize or mitigate risk. You are all now your own bosses to a certain extent, right? You have to get leads, you have to get the tool sets, but we don't demand that you work certain, well, let me rephrase it. I know some people do. We give you the flexibility in your hours and we don't take any taxes out and you don't report or have a manager. You don't report to anybody directly, true? So I want you to mitigate risk. Everything that you do should be in your mind saying to yourself, am I making my $1,000 an hour? And am I mitigating or minimizing my risk? If I had to log into somebody else's tool forever, I think that that's a risky proposition to me. Because at any point in time, something could happen to that tool. Now, what do I do? I'm not talking about the tool for HP Pro or whatever, because that's required by working with American Income Life and AO. I get that. But everything else, I want to control, whether it's Zoom, Calendly, my Excel files, my ability to make calls using my tools on my own platform, all of that stuff. So Janelle, I know you just got a long-winded answer to your question. Bottom line is, if you try to record in those rooms, I don't think you have the ability to do so. So you'd have to have them do it. And I've not heard that ever being successful because they're really busy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Woo. Camille Thomas, am I talking too much today?
Absolutely not.
Okay, well, I'm going to stop the talking because guess what we are going to do now at 10 minutes past the hour. Wade Dawson, what do you think we're going to do now?
We're going to go to breakout rooms.
Very good. And what are we going to do in those breakout rooms?
We're going to break dance. No, we're going to go through our presentations.
We're gonna
happy, break right? Be happy.
That's right. So I am going to create, let's see, there's 35 of you in the room now. So 35 divided by 30 should be 12. All right. I am creating 12 breakout rooms. You're going to be assigned automatically. One of you is going to role play as the client. The other one's going to be the agent. And you are going to do part A in its entirety, all the way through. And you're going to populate every field that's available for you to populate. And then you know how to call me if you need any help or assistance. But what I'm expecting to see is that you're sharing your screens, you're using HP Pro, you're filling out all the information. And the way that I know you'll are, the way I know you're finished is you're going to email me the downloaded documents. Yeah. Andrew Mongar, are you with me?
Yes, sir, I am.
Okay. You feel confident about getting through all of part A?
I worked on it a little bit last night, so I'm better prepared, but still a little wavering in my confidence with it.
No worries. I'm learning. We're not testing each other. We're not evaluating. You're going to help each other get through it, but one person at a time is going to go through all of this, okay? And the rooms will be automatically assigned, that being, because it doesn't matter to me who you're working with. As a matter of fact, I want all of you to get to know each other because you're building the legend in this class. A lot of you will be around for a long period of time. I want you to remember working with each other because as you get promoted and move up and you win all these contests and you go to Hawaii, Cancun, Amsterdam, you'll see each other. You're like, I remember you, Erica Daniel. I remember you, Amber. I remember you, Sarah Dizimona. You're the one that was drinking in the middle of the class almost every single time, right? I mean, not drinking, but drinking. You know what I'm saying?
Drinking tea.
Or I remember you, Michael Weatherby. You're the guy that Sam kept calling on. It's giving a hard time to. And then you finally went out and bought a ring light. Now you're no longer in the shadow. That was your legend. And what that means is years down the road, we bond, right? We get closer together. Because at some point, you're all going to be in leadership, in my mind. And you're all going to help each other for the entire organization to continue to move forward. Do I have any questions before you go into your breakout rooms? Look at that. No questions. Oh, Alexa just said she didn't understand. Yes, Riley, what can I do for you?
You said that we know how to call you if we need help, but I don't know how to do that.
So down at the bottom where you would normally put your reaction and raise your hand, when you're in the breakout rooms, it will say, I believe, ask for help. And okay. When you click on ask for help, no matter where I'm at, it pops up on my screen. Now, to be fair, there's going to be a bunch of breakout rooms I might not be able to get to you quickly, but I will eventually get there, okay? Yeah. Marinette, what can I do for you?
Yeah, I'm still not able to share my screen for my iPad because here in France, everything is complicated. I ordered a new computer that was supposed to be delivered yesterday. No, yesterday it wasn't, neither today. So I'm not sure my iPad will do the job. So just to let you know in case.
Okay, we'll work with your classmates. And if you end up just being the role play partners, the client, that's fine.
Okay.
But the whole point is we need to practice a lot. So if you're not able to practice in class, you're going to have to practice on your own, okay?
Thank you. I'll do so. Thank you so much.
All right. You're all awesome. Everybody, the rooms are open. Please start joining and let's do part A of our presentation. What is happening, everybody? We are back. Did we get enough practice? No? Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. We got
it. Yeah, I enjoyed it.
We can always.
How about we got some practice? I wouldn't necessarily say it is enough practice, but certainly we got some practice in. What was the major challenge that you had, Nicole Parker?
At first, it was just trying to share each other's screens and making sure we were sharing the correct screen, kind of navigating back and forth between giving the presentation and looking at the script.
Okay. So it's a little challenging, yeah? But you'll get it down. It'll become second nature to you as you do it more and more and more. I know I have three people that are going to stick around after the class, but Amy has a question. Amy, what can I do for you?
Oh, no, I was more so just going to say that I think the hardest thing that I, or the biggest thing I had an issue with was just knowing which attachment to click on and show at the right time in the script, mm-hmm. you know, because it will say like, oh, show this one. But I'm like, okay, where is it?
And did your roommates help you out with that?
Oh, yeah. Those girls are bomb.
Hey, as long as they're bomb, that's all that really, really matters. So we know what the homework is, right? We know what we're going to do over the weekend or maybe tonight before we leave. And we know when it's due by, except for one person who's going to give it to me on Sunday by 10 a.m. And that's Sophia Jackson. Morgan, your hand is up. How can I help you?
I was just going to say that my biggest issue was getting ahead of the script. Like, I was so, like, into talking and making sure we had a good rapport that, like, I'd be like, all right, so this was, and then I'd find out that, like, I had skipped the script, but technically had done it just in different words. So it was hard for me to find out where I was in the script because I went ahead of it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I understand that completely. So it's just going to be more and more practice, okay? As we get better at it and more comfortable at it, we will be more proficient. And as we become more proficient, we will increase our efficiency. All right, everybody. A quick note. I had somebody jump into my Zoom while you guys were on break, or I'm sorry, not on break, but some of you were on break, but most of you were still in the room. And I just want to make sure that everyone understands this training concept, what we have going on here. So first of all, I'm a facilitator. Yeah, we all agree that I said that I was a facilitator. That's number one. Number two, I am not aware that we make this a mandatory class. And what I mean by that is all of you work with your uplines. They tell you what you should do, what you should attend. I don't make you stay here, right? I let you take the breaks when you want. I tell you when I'm going to take a break, et cetera, et cetera. So my whole point there is work with your uplines, figure out what makes sense for you. We know that training like this is absolutely crucial because what it does is it reduces how long it takes for you to come up to speed, okay? So if you think the class has value, then once you're finished with this class, which will be next week, the best way to handle that or the best way to say, yeah, I thought it was pretty good is to in fact do what? Recruit people, and if you do recruit people, recommend that they go through the course. Right? I can work with all of you one-on-one, and I think that would be good, but it may not be the most effective way to touch as many agents as possible. Is that a fair statement? Mm-hmm. And so we want to make sure we touch, not touch, but you know what I mean? Work with as many agents as we can to get them to a point that they feel comfortable and that they can talk to their clients with some level of confidence so they can provide the no-cost benefits. And then if necessary, or if it's wanted, the actual life insurance policies and the health, if you have that. So for all of you here, it is the last day of the first week. We have one more week together. We will continue to do practicing start on Monday. I fully expect everybody to have their homework to me by, what did I say, midnight tomorrow. So if you can submit that, that gives me an opportunity, right, to look and assess kind of where all of you are at. If you don't turn it in by midnight, except for Sophia, then I won't have the chance to look at it because I just won't have enough time on Sunday. Does anybody have any questions for me? Yes, Andrew, what can I do for you?
Okay, so that's midnight on your time. So that would be, what, 2 a.m. my time, correct?
Well, right I'm now, it's about 1 o'clock. So is it 3 o'clock where you're at almost, or is it 4 o'clock?
It's about 4.
Yeah, so that would mean that it would be 3 a.m. Sunday morning.
Okay. Oh, I was pushing for midnight, so that helps. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, whatever you can get it done. I'm just here trying to help you and give you feedback on where you're at so that you can assess how much more work you need to do in terms of practicing. Olga, do you have a question for me? Olga's like, please just let me go. The agony. All right, everybody. I, as always, will stick around for whatever questions anybody has afterward. I know there's three of you that wanted to chat with me after class. That's great. I won't see you tomorrow because tomorrow is Saturday, but I fully expect to see all of you on Sunday as I start to go through all of the videos. I'll see you then. If not, I'll see you in person on Zoom. The next time will be Monday morning at 9 a.m. Pacific time. Thanks a lot, everybody. Have a great weekend. Take care.
Thanks.
Bye.